Okay, so good morning or good afternoon, depending on where you are, everybody, and welcome to the third week of the school. This week, we will have lectures by Professor Marco Peloso and Professor Massimo Pietroni on inflation, reheating, and large-scale structure. And before I introduce the first speaker, I would like to remind you that I sent a message on Slack about some brief interview with students about their experience with theoretical physics so far. So if you're interested in participating in one of these interview, please send me an email, as I wrote you on Slack, okay? The interviews will happen this week. We will arrange a time in private. So let me go now to the first speaker. It's a pleasure for me to introduce Marco Peloso. Marco studied physics at the University of Trento, and then he got his PhD at CISA. After his PhD, he was postdoc at the University of Bonn and the University of Toronto. And then he was a faculty member at the University of Minnesota until 3 years ago, more or less, when he came back to Italy, and now he's a professor at the University of Padova. Marco is a real expert on inflation, reheating, and all the topics he will discuss in his lectures. So I'm very happy to leave the floor to Marco for the first lecture.
Hello, everyone. So thanks a lot to Francesco for the introduction. And my goal here is to give some lectures on inflation and the reheating. And I decided also in consultation with organizers to be very basic and to try to make sure that also people who don't really work on cosmology can follow this lecture and hopefully can get benefit from that. So I will divide this lecture in three parts. First will be introduction to inflation itself. So there will be motivations. Then there will be very simple realization. So there will be not much models, but at least a very basic idea. And then we will have an extended discussion on perturbations, because of course it's from perturbations that we really can get observable consequences. And then the next will be related to particle production, but there will be production at reheating, so after inflation. And there will be essentially non-perturbative production. Actually, we will start with perturbative. And then non-perturbative. And then there will be the third part, which will be production during inflation. Which will have consequences like to the CMB. So there will be some modifications. And then also possibility of having interesting phenomenology in gravitational waves. So these will be phenomena of particle physics production, and these ones will have probably the most interesting observable consequences on very large scales. Okay, so that's about it. And I will immediately start with the first part. And just to set notation and to introduce motivations for inflation, I want to discuss, first of all, let me cancel this as well. I will discuss, first of all, the expansion in standard cosmology. So cosmological expansion. Standard cosmology. And the first thing we note, right, is that the distances are proportional to a function of grows with time, so distances grow. And then from the scale factor, we define the Abbot rate, which is the logarithmic derivative of the scale factor. So dot denotes the time derivative. And then just to set the units, we work, we define the mass, the reduced Planck mass in terms of Newton constant. Which is 2.4 10 to the 18 GeV. And we will work in natural units. So H bar is equal C is equal K Boltzmann is equal one. And we think to the presence of a perfect fluid. Which has energy density. In a pressure. So it's a fluid at rest in the CMB, in the cosmological rest frame. And we define the equation of state to be the ratio of these variables. So here is essentially all we need to set up our discussion. And then we just look at the Einstein equations for this setup. And we can see from the equations, we can write two equations. One is, let me just specify a flat universe. So energy density controls the expansion rate. This is actually Friedmann equation, which is the 0-0 Einstein equation. And then you can have a conservation, a local conservation of energy, essentially. This comes from combining Einstein equations, or in an equivalent way, this is just the conservation of energy momentum tensor, the zero component. So we have two unknowns, right? How the scale factor evolves with time, how the energy density evolves with time, and we have two equations. And let me not write down the explicit solution, but let me just write it down without deriving it. You can show that from these equations, we will get that the energy density scales as this power of the scale factor. And then the scale factor behaves with this power of time. And maybe I'll give them as an exercise. Not very hard. You saw these differential equations, and an exercise, for example, could be to see that the solution is given by this quantity, by this equation that I wrote there. Now, in standard cosmology, what we mean? We mean matter plus radiation. So matter is an equation of state W is equal to zero. Radiation, by radiation, I mean relativistic particles. For example, could be neutrinos at high energies or photons, have an equation of state, W is equal one third. So when we write, we specify these relations to these two species, of course, for matter, right? We see that rho scales as one over a cube, which makes sense. Energy density is proportional to one over volume. And the scale factor goes as t to the two thirds. So that the Abel rate is 2/3 t. Instead, if we do for radiation, rho goes as 1/8^4. So we see expansion due to the volume, but also the individual photon loses energy as 1/A, just because the photon redshifts. And then here the scale factor goes as t^2, and the Abel rate is 1/2 t. So this board has the result for standard cosmology, for expansion in standard cosmology. And that's about it. That's all we're going to need for these lectures. And now, in the next few minutes, I will discuss why this is this gives rise to problems. Written like this, nothing seems to be really a problem. But in fact, observations are not fully easily explainable once we have these equations here. And there is an issue of what I would say initial conditions. So this is the equations, of course, this is how they evolve, but we need now to understand whether the initial conditions are that lead to the observed universe make sense or not within this picture. I will be more specific now. So now I'm starting the part of the lecture where we discuss motivations for inflation. I want to show that these solutions here, although mathematically correct, cannot really explain very easily the observations that we make. So I want to discuss what we call the horizon problem. So sophisticated, we can define horizon in a more sophisticated way, but let me be super simple. I would just say the horizon is the region that grows with the speed of light. So this is just a region that expands with the speed of light. So very simply, the horizon is let me just write CT. I don't want to go into any detail. I just want to have a very simple intuition on what's going on. Now, as I say, we work in units C is equal one. So let's forget about C. And if you remember, in both cases, with matter domination, H is 2/3 T. With radiation, H is 1/2 T. But in a sense, H is the inverse of T. So in a sense, the horizon is 1/H. Very, very simply said. And there is a problem really due to the fact that the horizon grows faster than physical scales. If I say like this, it's not really obvious what the problem is, but now let's understand why there is a problem associated to that. So let's do a cartoon where we will see really the problem. And imagine that there is a region. This is the sky we see today. This, in a sense, is our horizon. So it's the horizon today, right? Is what I see, what I can see today is what regions of the universe that were able to send light to me. So this is, I get radiation from my horizon. And then I want to see how this region looks like at early times. Of course, if I go to early times, this region was smaller. So this is the same region at earlier times. Why was it smaller? Because the scale factor grows, right? And in particular, remember the scale factor goes as t to the half or 3 to the 2/3, depending whether we are in radiation or matter domination. The same region that we see today in the past was smaller. But now let's think in terms of a horizon. The region that we see today is the horizon today. But if I ask myself, what was the horizon at this time? I remember that the horizon scales as t. So of course, the horizon will be much smaller. So this region here is the horizon at earlier time. So what is the consequence of all this is that the sky we see today is made out of many regions that were the sky that is connected to me, when I look in the past, it was made of many regions, but these regions did not have time to talk to each other. Yes, please.
So there is a question from her, and then she can.
Hi, thanks. I didn't quite follow the argument about why the region should actually be smaller than what you originally drew in the diagram. Could you repeat that, please?
I'm sorry, the audio is not very good. Can you please repeat the question?
Oh,
more slowly, please.
Microphone, is this better?
Yes.
Okay, sorry about that.
Please repeat.
Could you repeat the argument about why the region should be smaller than what you originally drew in the diagram? I didn't quite follow that.
Okay, very good, very good. You know, I was saying that physical scales grow with the scale factor. That's the meaning of the scale factor. If the scale factor doubles over time, it means that the size of the region doubles over time. And before we were showing the solutions, and the solution were that the scale factor, if the universe is filled with radiation, grows as the square root of time. You see, as time grows, scale factor also grows. If the universe is filled with matter, it grows with a different power, but you see, it still grows. So here is a region. You should think to this as a concrete sphere in the universe. Is the sphere that talks to me. I am here, and this is the sphere that talks to me, where radiation arrives to me. This is the part of the universe that I can see. This part of the universe I cannot see because it's too far from me. But this is my horizon, is the part of the universe that I can see. Now, if I go back in time, the universe was smaller. That's all I'm saying. So the region that today has this size, earlier in time, it had a smaller size because the scale factor was smaller in the past. But then also the horizon was smaller in the past, but the horizon was smaller by a bigger power of time. So if I look at the size of the horizon, it was smaller than the region. So this one is the region scaled back in time. And instead the smaller dot is the size of the horizon at that earlier time. Did I answer to your question?
Yes, it does, thank you.
Great.
Say that at the beginning, but feel free to interrupt at any time, and I will make sure to.
I always be happy to reply. So, essentially, that the conclusion that we had from our discussion is that the sky I see today in the past was not fully connected. There were many regions that did not have really time to talk to each other. And so these regions, in principle, I don't expect them to have the same properties, right? Because if this region was never able to communicate with this region, why should this region have the same energy, for example? And let's particularly see what this implies numerically for the CMB. You know, the CMB is radiation that was emitted when hydrogen atoms formed. Very early in the universe, the protons were decoupled from the electrons and radiation was not moving freely. But at some point in the history of the universe, hydrogen atoms form and the universe becomes transparent to radiation. This happens when the scale factor was about 10 to the minus 3 with respect to the scale factor today. So with the index zero in cosmology, we always mean today. And I want to see what the quantity that we are caring about, which is the horizon divided by physical scales, changes. The horizon, remember, is T. Physical scales is T to the 2/3. So this is T to the 1/3 or scale factor to the 1/2. So the ratio between the horizon and the physical scales changes as the scale factor to the 1/2. So if I do the horizon divided by a physical scale at the time of the CMB, I divide it by the horizon divided by a physical scale today, I get square root of 10 to the minus 3, right, this number here. And this would mean essentially 0.03. That's about the square root 1/1000. So pictorially, what does it really mean? It means that when I look at in my sky, if in some units the radius of my sky is 1, the portion of the horizon at that early times only occupies a fraction, which is 0.03. Because remember that the horizon was shrinking much faster when I go back in time. Therefore, the angle that I see the horizon at these early times essentially is the arc sine on 0.03, which of course is 0.03 radians, which is about 1.7 degrees. So what does it really mean? It means that when I look at my sky, regions that are farther apart than 1.7 degrees were not able to communicate where CMB was emitted. So regions farther apart than 1.7 degrees on my sky were not bored. So what we understood earlier was that the horizon grows faster than physical scales. So when I go backwards in time, the horizon was smaller than a physical scale today. And in particular, we see that we consider the ratio between the size of the horizon and the physical scale. And we found that this quantity here was proportional to the scale factor to the 1/2. And then instead of being generic, we consider a specific situation, the size of the horizon when the cosmic microwave background was emitted. The cosmic microwave background that we see today was emitted when the universe was 10 to the minus 3 in size with respect to the size today. And so essentially this ratio here was 1/1000, which means 0.03. So what does it really mean? It means that this is the radius of the region that I see today that I normalized to 1. Instead, the size of the horizon at the time when CMB was emitted, it is 0.03 on my sky. And so I can ask myself, what is the angle at which I see the horizon at that time? And I see it with an angle that it is 0.03 radians, which is 1.7 degrees. So what does it really mean? It means that regions in my sky that are farther apart than 1.7 degrees, they didn't have time to communicate with each other when the CMB was emitted. So I don't expect, I should not expect that the CMB has the same temperature for regions that are farther apart than 1.7 degrees. But then I look at the cosmological data, I look at the CMB, and the CMB instead has the same temperature everywhere. So when I look at the CMB that comes to me from very far apart regions, the same temperature of about 2.7 Kelvin is found from every region. And the question is, why should regions that didn't have the time to communicate with each other, they all have the same temperature? And this is what is called the horizon problem. Now, the horizon can be understood as, so what is really this problem coming from? This problem is coming because, as we say, the horizon grows more than physical scales. So the problem is because the horizon divided by the scale factor grows. But what is the horizon divided by the scale factor? Remember, this is 1/ah. But remember that h is a dot over a, so it's 1/a dot. So the problem is because a dot decreases. What does it mean, a dot decreases? It means the expansion is decelerating. So the problem of the horizon problem arises because the expansion is decelerated. So as you can see, right, because of the expansion is decelerating, then there is this problem, which is the horizon problem. If I look in terms of the initial equations, what does it really mean? Well, remember that the scale factor is T over 2, 3, 1 plus W. And then what does it mean that the problem is because the universe is decelerated? The problem is because 2 divided by 3, 1 plus W is smaller than 1, right? If this is smaller, if this power is smaller than one, it means that the expansion is decelerated. So let's solve this equation. 1 plus W is greater than 2/3. W is greater than minus 1/3. So the equation of state of matter and radiation is indeed greater than minus 1/3. As a consequence, the universe is decelerating. And as a consequence, there is the horizon problem. Is there any questions on this? There is one question, very good.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, can you please repeat why the universe is decelerating? Actually, I haven't got your point, I think.
Okay, so you the horizon grows more than physical scale, right? This is what generates the horizon.
Marco, there are audio problems again.
I don't know what to do. I am not in control of the technical aspects. Is it working better? I'm afraid the connection is not very good, and so sometimes the audio disappears. The answer. We discussed before, the question was to explain again why there is a problem with deceleration of the universe. And we understood before, right, that the problem is because the horizon grows faster than the scale factor, right? This was the origin of the horizon problem, that the mathematical function, dh of array, is increasing. But what is dh of array? Let's be slower with the algebra. This is 1 over ah. Because remember, we saw before that the horizon is 1 over h. So there is a problem due to the fact that this mathematical function is increasing. But let's go further with the algebra. This is 1 divided by a dot of array, right? Because the h is a dot of array. So you see that a simplifies, and there is 1 over a dot. The problem is due to the fact that 1 over a dot is increasing. Or equivalently, the problem is because a dot is decreasing. So the problem, because a dot is decreasing. So what does it mean a dot is decreasing? It means a dot dot smaller than zero. It means deceleration. There is a problem because the universe is decelerating. Now mathematically, we see that this implies mathematically, what does it mean that the universe is decelerating? Whenever the equation of state is greater than minus 1/3.
Yes, sir, I got it. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Now, let me discuss a different problem, completely unrelated problem. And it is the flatness problem. Now, if I look at the expansion law for the accelerated for the curved universe, I will get that it changes in this way. Where kappa is zero if the universe is flat. This was the solution that we discussed earlier. Otherwise, it's plus one or minus one if the universe is closed or open. This curvature term is smaller than 0.5% today. The cosmological observation tells us that this term is very small today, could be even zero. But it cannot be bigger than 0.5%. But now we observe that this term is the one that decreases the least as the universe is expanding. You see that the matter goes as 1/a³, radiation goes as 1/a⁴, dysthermia goes as 1/a². And if this term has to be subdominant today, in the past, it must be even much more subdominant, because you see, this is the one that decreases the least. In fact, you can show that when the universe was 1 second old, the curvature term must be smaller than about 10 to the minus 18. I leave this as an exercise to you. If you want to, you can use the equations that I was giving you before, and you can show, since this case is 1/a², in this case is 1/a⁴, you can show that this term, if it has to be smaller than 0.5% today, it had to be smaller than 10 to the minus 18 when the universe was 1 second old. And of course, the earlier you look, the smaller this term has to be. This is a very unnaturally small number. And again, this is considered not to be a natural solution. Of course, you can just put it, but this is not a very natural initial condition. And you see, where is the problem here? The problem is that the matter and radiation, they decrease faster than 1/a². Remember that the rho goes as 1/a, 3, 1 plus w. And the problem is because 3, 1 plus w is greater than 2, right? The problem is that these quantities here are greater than 2. Mathematically, that's the problem. So let's look at this equation, 1 plus w greater than 2/3, w greater than minus 1/3. Notice that is the same problem as before. Completely different physical problem, right? One is the horizon problem, one is the flatness problem, completely different physical problem, but mathematically they have the same origin. They both arise because the universe is decelerated. So now that we understand that there are other problems that I could discuss, but I don't want to spend all the lecture discussing the problems, I show to you two very different problems that they have a common origin. Notice that they are both problems of initial conditions, because I can decide I put initial conditions homogeneous, that's it. Or I could put initial conditions very, very flat. But the question is that we don't really feel, at least many of us, don't feel comfortable with these initial conditions. And inflation is a mechanism that tries to explain why there are these initial conditions. And you can see, right, you can imagine that the most simple way to imagine, so now we are really speaking about the idea of inflation, is that the universe was accelerating at some time in the past. So when? Well, at least it has to be earlier than 1 second. Because what is so magical 1 second? 1 second is where essentially nucleosynthesis starts, is the formation of the light nuclei, like helium, lithium. And we know that by looking at the cosmological abundance of these light elements, we know that we understand that the universe was radiation dominated, starting from 1 second old. So, but earlier, maybe the universe was dominated by something else, and this something else was driving to accelerated expansion. Then why does it solve the horizon problem? Because with accelerated expansion, a single region grows to cover all the sky we see today. So essentially, there is a moment earlier on where the expansion was much faster. And so a single region was able to cover all the horizon that I see today. And also because there is, let's say that the expansion, inflation, is driven by a field phi. But phi decreases, the energy of phi decreases less than the energy of the curvature. So if I look at the energy density of this field phi divided by the energy density of the curvature, this grows enormously during inflation because this will go as 1/a². And instead, this will be diluted much less. So the basic idea is that maybe at the beginning of inflation, the curvature was order one. But then during inflation, this ratio increases enormously. And then the field phi will decay into matter and radiation, but with an energy much greater than the energy in the curvature. That's the basic idea, essentially. This field, we call it inflaton field. And for simplicity, we choose it to be a spin zero field. There is not really evidence why we should give it a spin. So in most of the cases, we treat this as a scalar field, which we call inflaton field. So this was the fact that this could be a good solution was realized by Gut in 81. That's essentially where people started to think about this idea of inflation to set up good initial conditions for the universe that we see today. Now, the original model by Gut has a problem. And let me just very quickly explain what this problem is. You see, you want something that grows in an accelerated way. The simplest possibility, imagine you have a false vacuum. So this scalar field will have a potential energy. And this potential energy will have a true vacuum where the energy is zero. And it will have a false vacuum where there is an energy V zero. And imagine that the inflaton initially is trapped in the false vacuum. So you have, right, that A dot is equal V zero over 3 m Planck square root times A, where this is really a constant now. So what is the solution of this differential equation? The scale factor grows as E to the V zero 3 m Planck square times T. Is an exponential growth, right? This is called the Sitter solution. And this, of course, is an accelerated expansion. So this works perfectly well for inflation. But of course, today, inflation has to be stopped. So this has to finish. How does it finish? Well, with the decays of the false vacuum. You know that the false vacuum can tunnel with some decay rate gamma. And then this can cause the end of inflation. But now there is an issue that this variable gamma, the decay rate of the false vacuum, can be either greater than the Abel rate or smaller than the Abel rate. If it is greater than the Abel rate, inflation lasts too little. Essentially, as soon as inflation starts, it immediately is over because the decay rate is too big. So what happens instead if the decay rate is small? Well, what it happens is that in the universe, there will be regions where the decay takes place. You know, by causality, this tunneling doesn't occur everywhere in the universe. It occurs only in some random small region. And then these regions expand with the speed of light. And so the idea of Gut is that when these bubbles expand, because the true vacuum, right, prefers to take over the false vacuum. The idea of Gut is that these bubbles would expand, the walls of the bubble meet each other, and when the walls crash, they produce particles, and this would be the phenomenon of reheating, how you heat the universe after inflation. However, Gut himself realized that this is not, this doesn't really work as this, because it's true that the bubbles expand, but remember that the false vacuum is still a DS universe, a de Sitter universe. So the space between bubbles expands even faster than the bubbles themselves. So these bubbles may never meet because here there is an exponentially growing space. So the bubbles actually go farther apart from each other. So in each bubble, there is no reheating. The universe is empty. It's just a bubble that is expanding, but these bubbles will never see each other. This is called graceful exit problem. The universe doesn't reheat in this version of inflation. So the idea of Gut was great, very correct, but the specific realization added the problem that you cannot do reheating. But this is something that people understood very, very quickly how to overcome. And they said, okay, let's not have a false vacuum. Let's just have a region of the potential, which is very flat. So this is V, this is V five. So let's imagine that I have a potential like this. Here, the potential is very flat. So this is similarly to a constant vacuum energy. Because this changes very little, if during inflation the inflaton moves very slowly, there's going to be a phase during which this is nearly constant. So you will have a nearly exponential growth. Please, I see there is a question, so please. You see, such a bubble would just be empty. So if there is the decay of the false vacuum,
I think that every time someone asks a question, we have a problem with the connection. So I suggest that maybe Francesco reads the questions directly to the speaker, and we avoid this problem then, okay?
Okay.
Hello?
Can you hear me?
Yes, now I can hear you. But in general, I think it's better if Francesco reads you the questions, because the connection, I think, has problem when the question are asked, okay?
Diego, can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Okay, let's... So the question was, why? How do I know that I don't live in such a bubble? It is just the energy of this field. The bubble is expanding, but this energy of this field has not been converted to matter and radiation. Since I know I'm made out of matter, I know that I don't live in such an empty universe. That's the answer to the question. Now, if there is other question, as it was just saying, maybe you can write. Okay, Francesco is going to tell it. And you find yourself here, you know that there's going to be a probability to decay. Gamma is essentially 1 over the lifetime of this region. This is just a mathematical calculation. This is just a tunneling in quantum mechanics. This actually is a phenomenon of quantum mechanical tunneling. So this vacuum cannot live forever. It has to decay with some probability. That's a given. It's just a calculation of tunneling in quantum mechanics.
Maybe, Marco, the problem is really when I read the question with the mic. So maybe I can tell you the question, you repeat the question.
Yes, so maybe there is a problem with the mic. So now Francesco is, please, if you have questions, type them, and then Francesco will tell them to me by voice.
We have one.
Yes, please.
A new one.
Very good, very good. So the question is, how do you make particles out of bubbles? So imagine you have in two bubbles, and the two bubbles are expanding. That's the basic idea. Then when the bubble mesh cross against each other, there is energy in the bubble that gets converted into the fields. Because the fields, any field like protons, quarks, electrons, they have different properties in these two vacua, and so the fields fill the change in the vacuum. And the change in the vacuum will lead to production. Actually, during this lecture, at some point, I will discuss the particle production due to a change in the vacuum. This is a phenomenon of non-perturbative particle production that I will discuss with you. Okay, so now these are essentially models of fast roll, like Linde, slow roll, sorry, Linde and Albrecht Steiner. They realized that why do we need a false vacuum? We just need a region of the potential that is sufficiently flat. In this case, during this evolution is like having a vacuum energy. And what do I need to get W smaller than minus a third? From the energy momentum tensor associated with this scalar field, we can show that the energy density is a half phi dot square plus V, and the pressure is a half phi dot square minus V. And so I see that if phi dot is small, then the equation of state is very close to negative number. In particular, right, what I want that P over rho is smaller than minus a third. If this happens, the universe is accelerated. And if you do the algebra, you can verify that this means V greater than phi dot squared. So as long as phi dot is small, the universe is indeed accelerating. As I'm gonna show you now, it is not enough to saturate this inequality barely, but this has to be very much unequal. And this will be because of the behavior of the perturbations. But this, I will discuss it in a moment. There is another question, please. Two questions, great. I like questions, so keep them coming.
So I, if I speak here, you can hear me from home.
I think it's better in the previous configuration.
Okay, okay. First question. The transition which takes place from one vacuum to another vacuum, is it first or second order?
So the question is again about the vacuum decay. If it is first order or second order, this is a first order phase transition. So that's the answer. Is there other questions?
Yes. Long question that I will read. Then it sounds somewhat counterintuitive to me that the energy from the decay is concentrated on the surface of the bubble, and that none is left in the form of particles inside the bubbles.
Well, but then these particles will move around, right? If you have a lot of it's just imagine. Boiling water, right? That's why you have bubbles forming in the boiling water, then these bubbles expand and they create a mess everywhere. So essentially, particles, you don't produce them and they stay there forever. They will just populate all the universe. They will essentially eventually thermalize and make and go everywhere. That's the basic idea. They don't just remain in that region. But the idea is that you need the bubbles to find each other. Now, I think that this discussion is very interesting, but maybe we should, when the questions become a lot on the same topic, maybe we have a discussion session tomorrow. So probably today we should maybe not have too many questions right now and use these questions for tomorrow. I think that's the. So if you have a short question, that's great. If you have long detailed question, I would keep them for tomorrow discussion session. And please write the question on Slack or in the chat so that we can keep track of them. Actually, it's great because then we will have a lot of material for tomorrow discussion. So I would suggest right now, if the question is important to understand what I'm saying, please ask it. If you see that it's a question that is more appropriate for a discussion session, then we should use it for tomorrow.
So somebody asked about the E and B equation. I think the E is the rho.
So this equation is the energy density, rho, and is given by this formula here. And this is the pressure. They come from the stress energy tensor associated with the scalar field. If you want, tomorrow I can go through the algebra. Right now I didn't prepare any detailed algebra. Phi is the inflaton field. We call it phi. We don't really know what it is. And as I say, since there is no evidence for spin, we just use a scalar field to describe the inflaton field. Okay, so now let me discuss essentially what I will show to you is that consistency with observation requires that the slow-roll parameter epsilon, which is defined in this way, and the slow-roll parameter eta, which is defined in this way, they must be much smaller than one. Eta is an absolute value. Prime denotes derivative. So it's not enough to have the potential barely flat. You really want a potential which is extremely flat. I will discuss to you why this is the case. So you really need a potential which is very flat in the region where the inflaton is moving during inflation. Now, what we are going to discuss, now the cosmological perturbations. So far, we discussed the background evolution, right? The universe is accelerated. But the real interest really starts when you discuss about perturbations, because these are the ones that we made observation from. And in particular, there is perturbations on the inflaton field. There is perturbation of the metric. And out of these perturbations, we get energy density perturbations. Delta rho over rho, which sometimes I call it zeta. And we also get gravitational waves. There is a full GR machinery that I'm skipping because this would take us hours on its own. But let me just give you the result. There are physical perturbations. There are perturbations in the energy density. And there is also possibility of creating perturbations in the form of gravitational waves. And these are the things that we can try to observe, or we have already observed in this case. And from that, we can infer properties of inflation. But before I do that, I need to essentially explain a property of what the perturbations do. And let me remind you that this is how things go on. So here is time. Here is a scale. And here is the horizon. Because now remember that H is proportional to rho to the 1/2, but the energy density is nearly constant during inflation. So the horizon is also nearly constant during inflation. Actually, rho decreases very little. So H to the minus 1 grows, but very little. Instead, during inflation, the perturbations wavelength, which is proportional to the scale factor, grows exponentially. So I can see that there are three regimes here, which I will call 1, 2, 3. And in the regime 1, the wavelength of the perturbation is much smaller than the horizon. So in the regime 1, which we call the sub-horizon, this is the size of the horizon, and this is the wavelength of the perturbation. The wavelength of the perturbation, right, lambda, is much smaller than the horizon. Now, you can show, the math is not very difficult, but I will not have really time to go through the math. But you can show, essentially, see, the Compton wavelength of the perturbation only probes a very tiny region compared to the horizon. And essentially, the perturbation doesn't really care about the fact that the universe is expanding, just because the perturbation is localized in small parts. And so it's true that the momentum is growing because the momentum is proportional to 1/λ, so grows as the scale factor. But the time of growth of the momentum is much slower than the oscillation of the perturbation itself. So essentially, the perturbation behaves as if it was in Minkowski, in flat spacetime. So the expansion of the universe changes essentially nothing of the properties of this perturbation. Now let's instead take a picture at the time 3. You see, at the time 3, the wavelength of the perturbation is much greater than the horizon. So at the time 3, which is called super horizon time, this is the horizon, and that's essentially the perturbation, because the wavelength of the perturbations is many orders of magnitude growing bigger than the horizon. Within each horizon size, the perturbation is constant. Essentially, the perturbation doesn't know about its own existence. And just due to causality, the perturbation is frozen. And nothing really interesting happens. The perturbation is just sleeping, because it's just too big to care about anything. It's just out of causal connection, essentially. So regime one is like Minkowski. Here the perturbation is sleeping. And here instead is the moment, which is the most interesting one, where the perturbation has the same wavelength compared to the horizon. So what does it mean? It means that here there is the horizon, here is the wavelength of the perturbation. And this is the only moment where really the perturbation is affected by the expansion of the universe. So essentially, this is the moment when the perturbation is imprinted. Loosely speaking, I will use the word created. Because really, the perturbation really is modified only at that moment there. So that's the moment where the perturbation is created. So what does it really mean? It means that when I observe this perturbation, I can learn what how the universe was at that given time. Because only at this time is the moment when this perturbation was created and was imprinted. Now, let me take a slightly different view. And then I will pause for questions, but let me finish the discussion. Let me take now the comparison between two different perturbations. So this is case, this is time, this is inflation, and this is the matter and radiation epoch. This is the horizon. Remember, here the horizon is nearly constant, then the horizon grows as the first power of the scale of time. And here is the growing of the wavelength of one perturbation, lambda one. And here instead is another perturbation, which is bigger. So what are lambda one and lambda two? Lambda one and lambda two are two perturbations on my sky. In my sky, I see a perturbation, lambda one, and then I see a perturbation, lambda two, which has a bigger wavelength on my sky. This is the behavior of the perturbation with greater wavelength than this. And you can see that this perturbation left the horizon earlier. So perturbations which have greater wavelength, they were produced before perturbations that have smaller wavelength. So perturbations which have greater wavelength, they give me the properties of inflation earlier in times. And this is going to be crucial for what we are about to say next. So since this is very important, I'm pausing to ask if there is any question here. Raise hand if you have questions. We intimidated her. Please, if you have questions, this is very important for what I need to say next. It's important to understand that bigger perturbations on my sky, they were produced earlier, and so they probe earlier times in the history of inflation. I hope that this message is clear because it's going to be very important for what I'm about to say next. Are you gone? Okay, very good. So now I will tell essentially three properties of cosmological perturbations. They are all due to slow roll. The first property is that the perturbations and nearly scale invariant. So why is this the case? So what does it mean, scale invariant, first of all? Well, when I look at the power of a perturbation, you see, if I take this perturbation zeta, the average of the perturbation is zero, of course, because perturbations just means perturbation over a background. But when I look at the second power of zeta, this I can write it as, if I go in momentum space, dk over k over pk. And this is called power spectrum. Remember that the wavelength of a perturbation is 2 pi over k. So in general, if I change the wavelength of the perturbation, it's like changing the wave number. And then the power spectrum will be a function of the wave number. And in general, this could be growing function, decreasing function. In general, this could be whatever you want. But the property of cosmological perturbation is that P of k is nearly k independent, which is really incredible. Perturbations which have different size, they are all produced essentially with the same power. But these can be easily explained in the context of slow roll inflation. Because remember the cartoon I told you before? And let's compare what goes on with the inflaton potential. Imagine that you have slow roll. What does slow roll mean? It means that the inflaton moves very little from one moment to the other moment. And this, for example, is the moment when lambda 2 was produced. And this is the moment where lambda 1 was produced. Remember, I was telling you that the bigger modes are produced earlier. So the inflaton is moving during inflation. When lambda 2 was produced, the inflaton was here. When lambda 1 was produced, the inflaton was here. But you see that the potential here and here is nearly the same, because the inflaton is moving very slowly. If the inflaton didn't move at all, the potential would be the same. And so these two perturbations would be produced identically. So you see, the point is that the inflaton moves very slowly. So different perturbations are produced when the potential was almost the same. So they almost probe the same potential. As a consequence, indeed, the power doesn't almost depend on the wavelength. In fact, if I write the law, the potential, the power is proportional to 1 over minus ns. 1 minus ns is equal 6 epsilon minus 2 eta. Remember, epsilon and eta tell me the derivative of the inflaton potential. This is the first derivative, this is the second derivative. If the potential is flat, then you see 1 minus ns is equal to 0, total scale invariant. In fact, the potential is not exactly constant, but there is slow roll parameter. The slow roll parameter tell me how much the potential is tilted. So this is the first property of cosmological perturbation. They have nearly the same power at all scales due to the fact that the inflaton moves very slowly. So different scales almost probe the same value of the potential of the inflaton field. The second property is a bit harder to understand. Let me try to explain it. It is the fact that the gravitational waves are much smaller than the density perturbations. So what is the basic idea? The basic idea is the following. Let me now write down a potential like this. Let me say that this is the value of the inflaton at the end of inflation. And this is the value of the inflaton when the CMB was produced. The inflaton is like a clock. The inflaton is moving. And the inflaton is telling me how much time is left to the end of inflation. Here, there is some time left to the end of inflation. But then the inflaton also has some perturbations delta phi. And there is a region where maybe the inflaton is here, is slightly higher than average, which means that there will need to be more time for inflation to end in that region. Is it working now? Okay, so let me repeat. I want to explain why gravitational waves are much smaller than density perturbations. The inflaton behaves like a clock. Here is the value of the inflaton when the CMB was emitted. Here is the value of the inflaton at the end of inflation. The inflaton has also some perturbations. So there are some regions in the universe where the inflaton is slightly bigger than average. These regions, it will take more time for inflation to finish. And the region will have a slightly greater energy density, because you see, they started slightly greater than the average. But what we care about is really the perturbation of this clock. So when I compute delta rho over rho, delta rho is how much the energy changes divided by the mean energy. You can see that in this picture here, you can relate this to delta phi over phi dot. Because phi dot is the background clock. It's telling me how much time is left to the end of inflation. Delta phi is the perturbation of the clock. But you see that the slower phi dot is, the bigger will be the amplification in the effect of the perturbations. And in fact, you can show that this is proportional to 1/√ of epsilon. Well, let me remind you that epsilon is essentially given by this quantity here. But physically, what happens? The slower the background clock is, the bigger is the effect of the perturbation in delta rho over rho. The same mathematical, the same physical thing does not apply to gravitational waves. So when I do R, R is defined to be the power in the gravitational wave divided by the power in the density perturbations. This will be S 1/ε. This is the second power. So this will be proportional to epsilon. So in a sense, the density perturbations are enhanced because the background clock goes slowly. Since the background clock goes slowly, delta rho over rho gets enhanced with respect to the gravitational waves. So when I take this ratio, I see the gravitational wave divided by density perturbation is suppressed by a power of epsilon. Now let me show you in a slide that I prepared, what is the observational consequence of this. So hopefully this is gonna work. We'll see. Hopefully this is working. Can you tell me if it works?
The screen is black so far.
Yes, let me go back to maybe the full screen doesn't work. Okay.
Now I see it.
Very good. So now, do you also see my mouse, my cursor?
Yes.
Good. So now, as I told you, slow roll implies the spectrum is nearly scale invariant. Slow roll also implies that the gravitational waves are much smaller than the density perturbations. And here are the contours seen by Planck plus other cosmological experiments, which indeed tells me that NS is close to one. So one minus NS is almost zero up to a few percent correction. And also R is consistent with zero up to a few percent correction. So you see that now we learn that these slow roll parameters need to be of the order of 10 to the minus 2, barring cancellations. Now, this is what we have observed. We have observed the density perturbations. So what we have measured a combination of H and epsilon, but we didn't measure H directly. The way to measure H directly would be to measure the gravitational waves, because you see that the power in the gravitational wave has not this epsilon enhancement that I was describing, but is only related to the expansion rate of the universe. So if we will be able to measure the primordial gravitational wave from inflation, we will be able to know the Abbot rate during the inflation, which will be given by this mathematical relation here, and we also be able to know the energy density during inflation, essentially. This is something that at the moment we don't know, because really what we have measured so far is the combination H divided by F. Measure the value of H on its own. Let me interrupt this slide and let me go back to the lecture. Now, a third property that I will not really discuss very much, that is the concept of non-Gaussianity. And perhaps I should be very quick here. So let me not be too long, but essentially the property is that when I look at the third power of zeta, let's say, this is much smaller than what I would imagine from a generic statistic. So what does this quantity mean? This quantity means average over my sky. I told you, right, that the average of zeta is zero, right? Because zeta is a perturbation. So zeta is delta rho over rho. the perturbation is defined to have average zero, but I can compute the second power, the third power, and generically, I would expect for a generic statistics, I would expect that this thing should be at the same order of this thing. However, in the case of that we observe, we find that the perturbations are very Gaussian. So what does Gaussian mean? Essentially, one of the properties means that this should be very much suppressed. Now, this is also a consequence of slow roll in a way that I'm gonna very quickly describe now. And let me start by this statement that the free fields are Gaussian. So imagine you want to compute the correlation function zeta to the fourth, but you use quantum field theory in, well, assuming Minkowski space and free fields. Then you know that you will have annihilation creation operators into each of them, and you know that they need to couple in pairs. So, and you know that mathematically we describe this as a contraction of this type. But then you can also have this other contraction, or you can also have this other contraction. So this means essentially that this is equal three times the two-point function and the two-point function. So this is in the hypothesis of free fields, and this is exactly what it means when you have a Gaussian statistics. Instead, if you compute the three-point function, you get exactly zero. So free fields obey Gaussian statistics, and by the way, the cosmological perturbation that we observe, they are very close to Gaussian. And so this implies that the perturbations interact very little among each other. And now let me think what type of interactions I could have. Well, I could have gravitational interactions, but gravity is weak. So perturbations will interact gravitationally, but gravity is weak. But also I could imagine the self-interaction of the inflaton field. You know, I can take a potential and I can tailor expand it. So there will be a minimum, then there will be the second derivative, then there will be the third derivative, so on and so forth. And these, for example, are interaction of the inflaton field with itself, but all the interactions are proportional to the derivative of the potentials. But slow roll implies that the derivative of the potential are all very small. So the potential, remember how I was drawing it. It is very smooth, very small derivatives, which means that the self-coupling of the inflaton field are very small, which means that there is very little departure from Gaussianity. In fact, there is a loophole in this thinking, which is about the interaction with another field. And this is, will be part of the last part of these lectures, that interactions with other fields are not constrained by slow roll, but depending on what model I have in mind. And so they can give greater non-Gaussianity. So again, right, non-Gaussianity is enhanced if you have interactions, otherwise you have free fields. Self-interaction need to be small because of slow roll, but interaction with other fields may give a more interesting value of non-Gaussianity, and that will be discussed in one, in probably in the last lecture. Now, let me ask, because there were many, how much time do I still have here? 15 minutes? Okay, good. One question, please.
So the question is, it's related to point two, you were listening to the previous one. What is the physical meaning of PGW?
Yes, the power of a field is defined from the two-point function. And essentially what it means what is the two-point function can be also related to the energy. What is the energy that I have in gravitational waves? All these perturbations have average zero. So if I look at the average, I don't get any meaningful information. But then I look at the two-point function, the two-point correlation function. This is proportional to how much energy there is in this perturbation. So I wrote before mathematically what is relation, but the physical picture you have in your mind, the power spectrum will tell you how much energy there is in these perturbations. Essentially, that's to be very quick. Mathematically is the relation that I wrote before, is the Fourier transform of the two-point correlation function. But physically, it tells me how much energy there is in the perturbations. Okay, so I think if I have 10, 15 minutes, I will just introduce the concept of reheating. So I will just make some 10 minutes remarks and then we stop here, okay? So far we discussed inflation and I told you that really it solves some of the cosmological problems. And moreover, it tells me what essentially properties of the cosmological perturbations are. But now we know that we don't live in inflation, right? And we know that inflation is over by today, at least the primordial inflation. And so something must have happened after inflation. Now the duration of inflation, because this will be important for what I say tomorrow. Is measured in E folds. So E folds are defined in this way. The scale factor is proportional to the scale factor at the end of inflation, e to the minus n. So you see, n positive means scale factor was smaller, means earlier in times. And this quantity n, it will be the subject of tomorrow's lecture, it is model dependent. But in many models, which we'll discuss tomorrow, keep in mind that n is the order of 60. So imagine now that the particle which was present at the beginning of inflation. But then the number density of this particle decreases 1 over the scale factor cube. And the universe expanded by a factor e to the 60 during inflation. So this means that this goes as 1 over e to the 180. Now you see that whatever was present at the onset of inflation is gone away because inflation is such a huge expansion that it dilutes everything that was present before the end of inflation. So what does it mean? It means that everything you see around was created after inflation, because anything that existed before inflation was gone. The only thing that was left during inflation is the energy of the inflaton field, essentially. So all matter and radiation that we see today was created either by the decay of the inflaton, or by some other light field that was amplified during inflation. And came to dominate over the inflaton at the end of inflation. The second option is much more complicated. Let me, I'll finish this and then, oh, please. I forgot what the previous. Yes. Okay. The number of e-folds is defined as the scale factor e to the minus n, value of the scale factor at the end of inflation. So if you go in the past during inflation, the scale factor was smaller, which means that n was a positive number. Now, the value of n is model dependent, and tomorrow we'll discuss this. In fact, we don't know what n is, but for many models, we know that n is in the ballpark of 50 to 60. So now imagine that you have a species, a particle, that is around at the beginning of inflation with some number density. But during inflation, the number density of this particle will decrease as the scale factor to the minus three, right? Because volume grows. And so it will decrease as e to the minus 60 per three. Of course, this is an incredibly dilution, right? E to the minus 180. So what does it really mean? It means that whatever was present at the onset of inflation is diluted away, and we don't really see it today. What we can hope to see today is the result of the decay of the inflaton. There is also another possibility, which is more complicated, and I will not really discuss it here, so I will write it in parentheses. It could be that during inflation, you amplify a different field, and this field eventually becomes more important than the inflaton when inflation is over. This is called, for example, curvaton. It's more complicated, and I will not discuss this scenario here. So barring this complication, essentially, during inflation, the only thing that is left is the energy density in the inflaton field. And nothing else really is around. And so whatever we see today is the product of the decay of the inflaton field. And this essentially is something that we call reheating. And already by seeing what I write here in a parenthetical, you can understand that reheating could be very complicated because many things can go on during reheating, and essentially we are quite ignorant of what went on. And so we denote as reheating a very generic set of processes. So let me see how I define it. Essentially, this is all processes from the end of inflation to the formation of a dominant thermal bath. So there is inflation, inflation ends, and then eventually the inflaton decays and the energy density gets converted into a thermal bath. But you see, this is not necessarily something immediate or something trivial. There can be a lot of things going on in this moment. And in general, reheating try to study all these possibilities. And there are essentially what we require. I'm gonna go on 5 minutes and then I'm gonna stop. So that's really the last concept I want to discuss today. We require, again, the formation of a thermal bath. With a temperature greater than about 2 MeV. Now, what is so magic here? You know, MeV is the energy in nuclear reactions, and 2 MeV is essentially when you really start to have a nucleosynthesis, when it starts. And then at these energies here, we know that there must be a dominant thermal bath. So reheating must lead at least with a thermal bath with at least this temperature. In most cases, the temperature of reheating is many orders of magnitude greater than this. But this is really the minimum requirement. Then you require the production of dark matter. And this will be, for example, the energy in dark matter divided by the energy in radiation at the time of BBN. This is about 10 to the minus 6. So you see, dark matter at this time was much subdominant, but you must have created it. This also was created during reheating. And also, you need to create a baryon asymmetry. You know, right, our universe has more baryons than antibaryons on a very tiny quantity. But still, you need to do it. And this also you need to do it during reheating. Finally, you must avoid to produce some particle, no overproduction. For example, of gravitinos, topological defects. But this is model dependent. So let me put it in parentheses because maybe you believe in supergravity, so you know you have supergravitinos and you have to care about them, but you could say, I don't believe in supergravity, I don't care about gravitino. So certainly this is a theoretical discussion that depends on the model you have in mind. But the other points instead are more essentially more true. And associated to this, let me mention what we don't know, right? So what we don't know is the theory. And this essentially is what makes reading a complicated subject, because there are a lot of things that we don't know. So one is the scale of inflation. So we don't even know when reading started, because we don't know what is really the energy of inflation. Then we don't know the nature of the inflaton, the particle nature of the inflaton, and its interactions. We don't really know. So did the inflaton interact a lot? Does the inflaton interact very little? And what is the evolution during reheating? This will all depend on what are the interactions of the inflaton field. And also, we don't really know the mechanism for production of dark matter and of baryons. Maybe it's thermal. So maybe it's something that is generated from the thermal bath, or maybe it's non-thermal. Maybe some decay that does not really involve the thermalization. So you see that there are a lot of unknowns, and there's a lot of theoretical ideas to try to explain these, but we don't really know what the correct one is. So I think I will stop here for today. Maybe I'll ask you if there are immediate questions. You can ask them now, or you can keep them for tomorrow during the discussion that will be tomorrow morning. So please, if you have questions, ask them now.
So there is one question on topological defects.
Yes. If you think it's a good idea, we can refer to. Yes, I will not really have much. So there was a question about topological defects. And this is something that I can mention tomorrow, but I don't have really very much to mention. But essentially, the basic idea is that they depend on the model, whether your model has some phase transition that leads to a stable topological defect. And they can have consequences on the CMB, for example. But we can discuss them more in details tomorrow. OK, so now I think I'm going to stop, and I give the room to the organizers again.
Okay, so I think the microphone works. I see other questions. I'm saving them, and we will discuss tomorrow sessions. So we will close the connection now, and the next lecture will be at 3:30. Please log in again, okay? Talk to you soon.